I don't think it's much of a secret that I tend to get a lot of requests to review something. Some of my reviews are based on these requests, or at least the general consensus. However, I do have standards in what I review, and some of the most popular requests are things that actively go against those standards. So I think that I just make it easy on all of us, and come up with the top 11 things that I'll never, ever review. What is the criteria for this list? At first, it seems like something that I could or should review, but it goes against one or more of these standards that I put out for myself. So I'm not even going to entertain things that aren't animated, or to those people joking, or at least I hope they're joking, about me reviewing something from growing around. I don't really know, but there just might be a little bias with that one. Also, if I said that I was going to do these reviews in the past, this list now takes precedent. Keep in mind that this list will count for both admirable and animated atrocities, so anything can go on this list. And yes, the numbering is largely arbitrary.
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 11, Over the Garden Wall. So apparently there was this really good miniseries that aired last year. It's creepy, charming, clever, and deep. I mean, everyone's been talking about it. Yeah, everyone's been talking about it. See, here's the thing with me. I don't like to talk if there's nothing new to be said. And I keep getting requests for things like Over the Garden Wall, Frozen, or really good episodes from TV shows like Band Geeks from SpongeBob. When I praise what's already well praised, the reviews tend to come out worse. Mainly because I'm pretty much just stating the obvious. Everyone knows that Over the Garden Wall is awesome. Everyone knows that Beauty and the Beast is awesome. I like to use admirable animation to talk about underrated gems, talk about what I'm passionate about, or give a new perspective on something. Now, I've broken this standard before, and I will do it again, but it'll be my choice to do so. And requesting me to review something that's almost universally praised like Over the Garden Wall is sort of a waste of a request.
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 10, Dingo Pictures or Video Brinquedo Films. Before you ask, know that universal opinion standard does not apply to atrocities. I will happily bash the most hated things ever and join in on the choir with them. Let's talk about when and why I review movies. Movie reviews are really hard and they take a lot of work, which is why people who do this shit weekly have my admiration. It takes a month for me to review a movie, and that month needs to have a special kind of target. These two guys here, they rip off Disney movies and they don't give a shit if their products are good or not. They just want to trick grandparents into buying their grandchildren shitty Christmas gifts. If I want to review a Disney ripoff film, I'll review a Disney sequel, because in general, Disney actually cares about what they produce, and they're able to feel embarrassed and ashamed of their crap. I like to review movies from companies that should know better, like Image Movers Digital or DreamWorks. Not to mention that there are bad movies that people are more likely to buy, like Happily Never After, The Nut Job, Virtually Any Cheap Ghoul, Quest for Camelot, or Delgo. These two companies here don't care about anything but a quick cash grab. And while a lot of companies are like that, almost none are this transparent about it.
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 9, Food Fight. I'm not gonna review it. Both John Trun and the Nostalgia Critic reviewed it. A lot of other people have reviewed it too. There is literally nothing new that I can say about this movie, beyond soundtracking it with, "It's terrible." If I feel that I can tackle a new angle with the movie than what others have done, I'll consider going through with it. In fact, I really want to review Quest for Camelot despite the Nostalgia Critic already reviewing it. I have a new angle there. There is no new angle here. It didn't make or break anyone's career, and it would have faded into obscurity if it wasn't so infamously bad. But you already knew that, didn't you?
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 8, Go Animate the Movie. When reviewing web animation, you've got to be very, very careful in choosing what you want to review. For one, most people who post animation to the internet aren't doing this for a job or something. They're doing it as a hobby. The only feedback they really need is the comments that they get. What I'm saying is that I only review things from actual professionals. Like, they can put animator or animation writer down on a resume. But Go Animate the Movie has an IMDb page, which is filled with lies. IMDb is a lot like Wikipedia. Anyone can really edit it and just say about anything. Want to know how I know that IMDb is lying about the Go Animated movie? Well, it once said that it came out in 2006. But in the movie, someone flat out steals an Adventure Time toy. Adventure Time came out in 2010. This movie was probably made by a high school student with a lot of free time on their hands. And considering some of my high school projects... What are you doing here? What the hell? Let's just... I'm not in much of a place to judge. Why did I do Control-Alt-Delete? Because Blind Ferret Entertainment claims that they're a professional animation company. For me to review a web animation, it would have to probably be associated with something like Channel Frederator or Cartoon Hangover. Why am I going to do YouTube Copyright School? Because YouTube, a company that should care about quality, got the Happy Tree Friends to do it. They're claiming some level of professionalism. I try to review things by professionals, or barring that, people who call themselves professionals. Not general hobbyists.
Check it out!
This is the Magic Punch. It's really powerful.
Number 7. Products of their time. One thing that you have to know about animation is that things are constantly evolving and standards are continually changing. And that's beyond old jokes becoming cliché. What was acceptable at one point might become taboo or forbidden at some point in the future. I'm not going to waste my time ranting about how cartoons made in the 80s were only around to sell toys. We now know that that's not what animation is for. Even toy-driven shows know that they have to do more than sell toys nowadays. I'm not going to review propaganda pieces from World War II or the racist cartoons from the 50s. Yes, they're bad. And we all know that now. For some reason, we didn't at the time. But standards do constantly evolve. It's hard for me to review a gross-out show from the 90s because they were all doing that. However, a racist cartoon or a gross-out show or what Family Guy calls political satire that airs today is still a game because we've moved past that as a medium and a society. Also, events can change the meaning of jokes or storytelling elements big time. Here's a clip from Sticking Around about the characters learning how to fly a plane in their imagination.
What's that?
An attack by
international terrorists!
Pepperoni! Blitz, I'm telling Mom!
We've lost engine number 3.
Captain Stickler, they're hijacking the plane. They want us to land in a foreign country.
As you can imagine, that's from before 9/11. Yeah, it was a different era. This is why I tend to review cartoons airing now, or ones that I grew up with. Because with the older stuff, I need to put it into a lot more context. For example, I want to do a review of I, My, Me, Strawberry Eggs. To do that, I need to not only know about the characters, the story, the humor, and the morals, I need to learn what the gender dynamics and attitudes towards homosexuality were in Japan 10 years ago. Sometimes it can be learned, and sometimes you gotta have been there to figure out what works and what doesn't. Sometimes I don't even get it when I was there. Also, this is why animated atrocity reviews generally don't lend themselves to non-fictional works. I'm not going to review an outdated educational piece from whenever.
Check it out!
This is the Magic Punch. It's really powerful.
Number 6. Family Guy, not all dogs go to heaven. This is on the list for a similar reason to Food Fight. This is quite possibly the most hated cartoon episode of all time. There have been essays about how this episode is horrible. And yeah, it is. Is it overhated? I really don't know because I can't relate to this episode and bring up the offense needed to review it properly. Oh, I know that the logic of Brian's defenses for atheism are flawed and stupid. It boils down to God doesn't exist because some women are not physically attractive. It's stupid, it's insensitive, it's the pivotal point where Family Guy decided to go start preaching its back-ass beliefs. But there's not much else to say. All it really does is help me figure out Seth MacFarlane's strengths and weaknesses. He is way better at playing offense than he is at playing defense. When he's attacking an ideology or belief that he personally agrees with, his logic is sound, and that ends up being some of his best work. However, when he's defending himself for conventions of his shows, he comes across as illogical at the best of times and hypocritical at the worst of times. But that is literally the only thing that I could add to this episode, because people have written thesis papers on everything wrong with the episode. Any review that I can come up with would be redundant. And speaking of redundant.
Check it out!
This is the Magic Punch. It's really powerful.
Number 5. The Simpsons, The Boy's a Bummer. This isn't the most hated episode of The Simpsons. That'd probably be The Principal and the Pauper, or maybe that 90s show. But it's definitely up there. It ends up in most people's worst lists, but not mine. So, what happens that makes it so hated? Well, Bart Simpson ends up being a star player in his Little League game, but during the final game, he ends up choking and losing the game. And then the entire town hates him to the point of turning him into a pariah. Now, where have I heard those themes before?
I get the feeling in this town, I'll never live till I live down the one mistake that seems to follow me around. But they'll forget about the sky when they all realize this guy's about to try to learn to fly or hit the ground.
I don't know which of these came first, but it's a goddamn amazing coincidence if there's no ripping off going on here. On top of that, the town taunts Bart so much that he actually attempts to commit suicide. By all means, I should hate this episode. But there's one reason I don't. The people who turned Bart into a pariah are seen as the bad guys. Marge makes the town realize what terrible people they were and smacks them down to reality. And they go through endless hoops in order to help Bart get his own confidence and his self-esteem back to normal. When Chicken Little made a mistake and the town hated him, it was presented as Chicken Little's issue and he had to earn his right to be treated like a goddamn human being. Here, it's the town's issue for not treating someone like a pariah for making it, in all reality, a simple mistake. Like, even other Simpsons episodes, like Regarding Margie, they put their morality with the wrong person. That tends to be what makes me hate an episode the most. Also, about the suicide. The Simpsons is aimed at an older audience and can be allowed a little bit more leeway using heavier themes. When Mr. Krabs did it, he somehow still ended up on top. When the town of Springfield did it, they had to keep repeating that same ballgame until Bart got it right. While I don't think this episode is all that great, Homer's subplot goes absolutely nowhere, I can't really review it as an atrocity because I don't hate it. Maybe it's because One Course Meal and Chicken Little were so much worse, and if that's the case, I don't have the ability to remove the bias.
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 4, Uncle Grandpa, any episode. No, this has literally nothing to do with its showrunner, Casey Alexander. My refusal to review an episode from Uncle Grandpa is solely on the show itself. Do I like it? Do I hate it? The short answer, nope. I don't like it, nor do I hate it. The easiest conclusion to draw from that is that I found it average, but no, I don't find it average either. I watched a bunch of episodes from this show. I watched the first couple and I was all like, okay. I watched episodes that I thought would piss me off personally and I was like, okay. In desperation, I watched episodes that I thought I would really like due to their plot lines or their themes and I was still like, okay. Uncle Grandpa is an anomaly for me. It's so wrapped up in its own logic that there's literally nothing I can relate to. Take the first episode. Uncle Grandpa is either telling a kid that you shouldn't be ashamed of being fat or that being fat has no negative consequences and actually is a positive thing. But throughout the episode, it never pushes towards either of the two messages. It follows its own logic, and that's something that I can't relate to. I literally have no opinion on this show. I wasn't aware that that was possible, but yeah, I have no opinion on Uncle Grandpa. And for me to review something, I kinda need an opinion.
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 3, Clarence, any episode. This one has everything to do with its creator. Like, I don't think that I have to say any more, because we all know what happens. And if you don't, you're lucky. Actually, I don't want to talk about it, because to be honest, I don't feel comfortable talking about it. And for me to review an episode of Clarence, I would have to talk about the incident. You wanna hear a little secret? I haven't watched any episodes of Clarence, and I don't have any plans to. Without even watching an episode of the show and having minimal knowledge of it, I know that nothing skeevy was intentionally added to any of the episodes. But on the other hand, with prior knowledge about what a creator thinks or does, you start to see hints that aren't really there. I also know that Skylar Page isn't working on Clarence anymore, or anywhere in Cartoon Network for that matter, but it doesn't really change facts. I'm not knowledgeable enough to talk about this stuff with ease and respect, nor am I skilled enough to wear myself carefully enough to avoid it. I mean, let's be honest, I've said terrible, horrible things about people who have done far, far less. I don't trust myself enough to deal with this.
Check it out!
This is the magic punch. It's really powerful.
Number 2. Any of the Shrek movies, any episode of South Park, any episode of the original Ren and Stimpy. This is a weird one and a weird bunch of things to group together. From the outlook, it may seem that I'm trying to avoid reviewing those not for me shows, but it's more than that. I mean, it's safe to say that Mr. Pickles is not for me, but I reviewed that anyway. What I'm about to say about any of these things may make some people very angry because they're insanely popular. Now, I'm not afraid of reviewing well-liked things negatively or give an unpopular opinion. I hate Drawn Together. I really love Meet the Robinsons, Atlantis the Lost Empire, and Treasure Planet. Before I continue, though, I will say that Shrek, South Park, and the original Ren and Stimpy are all good shows. Yeah, we're not talking about a adult party cartoon, not now at least. We're talking about the original. When something is really good, different, and gets really popular, it's going to have a crap ton of imitators. It becomes an influence. And sometimes, influence isn't really a good thing. Shrek paved the way for movies like Chicken Little, and is a large reason why 2D animated movies are so rare nowadays. Ren and Stimpy influenced the 90s so much that Gross Out is tied with it entirely. And South Park? South Park did to adult animation what Scary Movie did for parody. Everyone wanted to be South Park and tried to imitate it without knowing why it worked. Hello, Brickleberry, Mr. Pickles, adult party cartoon, Family Guy, and The Simpsons attempts to be relevant. Literally anything that's been on Adult Swim in the past 5 years. South Park, Shrek, Ren and Stimpy, they're all good products that have had horrible influences on the industry as a whole. Is it their fault? No, but it's hard not to be bitter towards them. South Park taught people that there was a market for adult animation. What they didn't teach adult animation is that there isn't a market for a second South Park. And virtually every adult cartoon has attempted to rip off South Park in the recent years. This happened in the 90s with Ren and Stimpy, but the swarm of poorly made gross-out cartoons died out. The popularity of CGI, with the advent of Shrek, hasn't. Not to knock CGI, but literally the only 3D animated film that I thought needed to be in 3D was Wreck-It Ralph. And lesser companies think that 3D is a get-rich-scheme way to make poor animated movies in order to make a quick buck. Hell, even Disney thought it at one point. My opinion is grossly biased, I understand this. I cannot watch Shrek without blaming it for Chicken Little, Ren and Stimpy for Mega Baby, South Park for Adult Party Cartoon, or Brickleberry. There have been bad influences on the industry before. Quest for Camelot. It taught studios that they could rip off Disney and end up better by making a worse product. There's an argument to be made that Quest for Camelot ended the animation renaissance of the 90s. But I can review Quest for Camelot because it's a bad movie, filled with Disney plagiarism and strung together by cliché after cliché, with total disregard for its source material. I can't give praise to Shrek without giving praise to its ripoffs, who tried and failed to do what it did. I can't do an atrocity review on Ren and Stimpy episodes because the bad ones didn't go far enough. And when you run into Mega Babies, it's just a recipe for disaster. And I talked enough about what I feel like adult cartoons have become in my Mr. Pickles review. Adult cartoons are like this because everyone tried to rip off South Park. Now, obviously I can't, at least with merit, be angry at South Park for this. But in a way I am. Yes, I'm biased. I'm ungodly biased. And that's why I can't review episodes from either of these shows or a Shrek movie.
Check it out!
This is the Magic Punch. It's really powerful.
Number 1, the Powerpuff Girls, See Me, Feel Me, Know Me. Guys, I am confused. Like, I am very confused here. So, a bunch of people told me that this was one of the worst Powerpuff Girls episodes ever and that I got, like, totally review it. Okay. So I decided to check it out and I added it to the list. I didn't think it was as bad as Town and Out or some of the other episodes made under Chris Savino, but whatever. I didn't think much of it. That is until a lot of people were outraged because a lot of people really liked this episode. I didn't want to upset that many people, so I decided not to review it. And then people started asking me to review this episode again, and you get the picture. It goes on in that circle for quite some time. So, let's talk about my honest-to-God opinions on this episode. I like it, but I am painfully aware of its faults. Yeah, this is what I'd call a guilty pleasure. There are plenty of things to like and plenty of things to dislike, to the point where I actually considered making it both an admirable animation review and an animated atrocity review. Why? Well, let's start with the fact that it's a musical. And as we all know, they're given a lot of, let's call it scrutiny. Well, here's the thing. With the exception of one line, the whole thing is sung. That's admirable. Is the singing good? Well, the main cast sings especially great, especially the guest star of Wacko Warner's voice actor, Jess Harnell.
Baton Rouge, Louisiana, Indianapolis, Indiana, and Columbus is the capital of Ohio. There's Montgomery, Alabama.
Yeah, him, except here he sings like Jack Black.
Ooh, I'll solve your problems, little girls, with a wave of my hand. The Mystic Elders gave me permission to conjure up a sacred light.
Most of the background characters like the mayor, though, they really shouldn't have been here. The lyrics do use a lot of repetition, but it's hard to write lyrics for 22 minutes. And most of these lyrics sound really good. However, what I dislike is the problem that tends to be in most musicals. The story. Okay, see, this gnome offers to take away the girl's power and remove all of the evil from the world. They sing a song debating if it's worth it, and not once question if the guy can be trusted. This gnome is apparently evil because he has arched eyebrows and makes people wear uniforms. Some people say that he's a communist, but I don't really see it. The episode attempts to teach the moral of freedom versus security, which is definitely admirable and needs to be done, especially more in animation. However, it's got a serious case of tell, don't show going on. It never shows the benefits of freedom and the consequences of sacrificing security for it, instead just settling to tell us what the right answer was. My biggest problem is the moral, though. I don't think it's offensive like One Bad Apple or hell, even Nobody Doesn't Like TJ, but it's very confused. The Powerpuff Girls sing at the gnome that you can't have the good without the bad, but at the end they're singing, "Why can't we all get along with the villains?" Jeez, girls! I don't know why you can't get along with evil. Maybe that's because you can't have the good without the bad. Like, isn't that what you just said 2 minutes ago? Maybe it's, like, absurdly meta, because we wouldn't have the good of this episode without its bad. The soundtrack is really good to the point where I've actually listened to it on loop while working on other reviews. It's very pretty to listen to and very nice to look at. Although it does use certain strobe effects, so I would not watch it if you have photosensitive epilepsy. But other than that, I'd actually recommend at least checking this out on your own and coming to your own conclusion about it. Yeah, what kind of critic am I that tells you to get your own opinion? Wait a minute, seizures. That makes me feel like I'm forgetting something.
We're the problem solvers, and we're really awesome at it.
That's a no-brainer.
Because these problems are not at all hard to solve.
The Problem Solvers. New series premiere starting Mondays in April.
Holy fuck!
I never tell you, you don't scare me. I ain't no fool. Look what's up my sleeve.
Oh!